Who was the first man in space? Who was the first man on the moon? Who was the first dog in space? If I ask you these questions, you probably know the answer to some extent. But if I ask you, who was the first woman into space? Do you even know the answer? Today, I want to shed a light on the first woman into space. Why? Because history is the study of humanity. And yes, that includes women. And I just like talking about the Soviet Union. Let's talk about Valentina Tereshkova. Born in 1937 in Maslennikovo, Russia, Valentina began her working career in a textile factory at the age of 18. When she was 22, she made her first parachute jump at the local aviation club. This jump was the first of many jumps that she would do that would later get her into the Russian space program and become the reason why she was picked to be a cosmonaut. But before we can dive into actual space travel, we need some context about the period that we now know as the space race. The space race is a part of the Cold War. The Cold War is a period of competition between the United States of America and the Soviet Union, roughly between the 1950s and the 1990s. In this period of time, the two superpowers were always in competition to outrace each other wherever possible. Arms, science, technology, culture, they were trying to outpace one another. Some people also view this as a competition between the two economic systems known as capitalism and communism. It was basically an ego competition to see which of the two superpowers or economic systems was the better of the two. One of the ways these egos got measured was by the space race. The space race started in October of 1957 with the launch of Sputnik 1 out of the Soviet Union. This unmanned satellite orbited the Earth for 21 days and transmitted radio signals. This raised fear and concern that the United States of America had fallen behind compared to the Soviet Union in developing new technologies. In November 1957, Sputnik 2 was launched, with inside it socialist hero Laika. In May 1958, Sputnik 3 was launched. Somewhere in 1959, Lunik 3 was launched and photographed for the first time ever the dark side of the moon. These were all successes of the Soviet space program. This string of Soviet successes led to the establishment of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA. NASA was founded in October of 1958 and was the official response to the success of the Soviet space program. Okay, back to Valentina. In 1962, Valentina was selected together with three other women, with a total of three parachutists and one pilot, to become the next cosmonauts. Just like astronaut training nowadays, cosmonaut training back then was grueling. There were a lot of applications from women, but a lot of people were not selected. The selection for cosmonauts was very tough. You had to be less than 1.70 meters high, you couldn't weigh more than 70 kilograms, and you had to be in perfect health between the age of 22 and 28. It is June 16, 1963. It is the middle of the day. 12:29 to be precise. A rocket blasts off from Baikonur. Inside is a female cosmonaut. She looks up at the sky. She says, "Hey sky, take off your hat. I am coming." Jaika breaks free from the Earth, writing history and changing the world as we know it. For the people watching, it is a scene straight out of a sci-fi movie. It is exciting, but this is reality. June 16, 1963. Valentina was launched as part of the Dual Vostok program. The craft she was in was called the Vostok 6. She and the Vostok 6 orbited the Earth 49 times for a total of 70.8 hours. That is just under 3 days. 48 more orbits than Yuri Gagarin, the first male cosmonaut in space, did on his trip. "I am Chaika. I see the horizon. There is a blue stripe. This is the Earth. How beautiful it is. Everything is going well." While she was in orbit around the Earth, she spoke to Soviet Union's leader, Nikita Khrushchev. "Valentina, I am very happy and proud that a girl from the Soviet Union is the first woman to fly into space and to operate such cutting-edge equipment." On her return trip, we found out why a parachutist was chosen for this mission, and why so many parachutists were trained to be cosmonauts. After her re-entry, she had to jump out of the spacecraft. This was not a malfunction. This was intended design. Glorious Soviet design! To my horror, she reported, I saw that I was heading for a splashdown in a large lake, instead of on solid ground. We were trained for such circumstances, but I doubted that I would have the strength to survive. After her spaceflight and return to Earth, she received the title Hero of the Soviet Union and became part of the Order of Lenin, showing that she had done a tremendous thing for the Soviet Union. She got married to fellow cosmonaut Adrian Nikolaev. They had two children, but divorced later in the 80s. During his marriage, she became a prominent member of the Communist Party. She represented the Soviet Union on multiple international tops. Most notable of these was the 1975 Women's Top of the United Nations. They named a crater on the moon after her, and she's on a stamp. Do you know who else is on a stamp? The Queen of England! She has the same privilege as the Queen of England! After the fall of the Soviet Union, she stayed active in Russian politics and even met President Putin in 2007. Nowadays, she's still active in local politics at the age of 83. When she met President Putin in 2007, she said to him, "If I had the money, I would enjoy flying to Mars." There is only one word to be said about this woman. Inspiring. Before I wrote the script for this video, I had not heard of her. And I think that's a shame. As I said before, history is the study of humanity. And we have a tendency to leave women out of this study. Women have done amazing things, just like men, but they are a lot less represented in history. That's why I opened this video with the question, do you know who was the first man on the moon? Who was the first man into space? Who was the first animal into space? We learn about the men in space. We learn about the animals in space. Why didn't we learn about Valentina? Little girls in classrooms right now can actually have a female role model they can aspire to be. They can identify themselves with. I'm not saying that men can't be role models, but we tend to look for role models who have the same gender as we do. I had a childhood dream, maybe a little brave, a little unusual, but entirely real and very possible to achieve. I always wanted to see the world with all its beauty, to learn its past and future, to guess the future, and to pass to others everything I found out and saw. Could I have ever thought that soon enough I'll see my country and our Earth through the window of a spaceship? The study of women in history can give us a lot of stuff to talk about. The different rights women had in the Soviet Union and the United States, for example. Representation of women in state. Questioning certain gender roles. This is all fascinating stuff. Since history is the study of humanity, isn't it unfair to exclude 50% of the population from this study? Isn't it unfair that women in history don't get the same attention that their male counterparts get? I hope this video taught you something, inspired you, and made you more interested in history in general. You can find links to all my sources in the description down below. Thank you for watching. Please leave a like if you enjoyed, subscribe for more, and leave down in the comments below what you want me to talk about next. Bye bye! Little after credit note here for everybody who was watching. The book I was holding during those comedic scenes was Das Kapital, the Communist Manifesto from Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels. Look it up, read it, educate yourself.